Hi, y'all. It's Angela. I'm back with another episode of Business Unveiled, and I'm super excited. Today, we're going to be talking with an intuitive business coach, and I have been around a couple of intuitive business coaches. Most recently, last year at a Cabo trip, there was this lady there and she was like a business intuitive, but she was more like psychic. So I'm excited to ask Jenny some of these fun questions. But really, we're going to be talking about how to make money. And really, money is a tool. It's a magical thing. And some people love money. Some people hate money. It's a love-hate relationship, but money is a tool that can help you get to so many new places to where you can help other people. And it really is magical. As silly as it sounds, I know some people are like, oh my God, Disney. And I'm like, no, I'm not a Disney girl. I work really hard for everything that I have. But we're going to be chatting about that today. And so Jenny, thank you so much for being here. Tell us about your worldwide business. Like, this is amazing. How did you, how did you decide, okay, I am going to be a business coach, an intuitive, and go around the world? Like, it just seems so exciting. So how did you decide to do that?
Welcome to Business Unveiled, the podcast designed to help you thrive in the creative community. Here's your host, events and productivity consultant, Angela Proffitt.
What's up, GSD leaders? Thank you so much for tuning in to another episode of Business Unveiled, where we share expert tips and secrets from top creative industry professionals. You know, we're going to take you behind the scenes of our experiences, share with you what we've learned from them and how it's made us stronger. Because no one said it's easy owning a business, right? But it's a lot more fun when you've got a strong support team around you. And that's exactly what we do at GSD Creative. We're right there by your side. And I'm so excited that you've chosen this podcast to take the first step in growing a productive, profitable, and successful, wildly successful business within the hospitality and creative industry. Today's episode is being brought to you by 99 Designs. 99 Designs is the global creative platform that makes it super easy for designers and clients to work together to create designs they absolutely love. You can get creative concepts from a multitude of talented designers. You get matched with the perfect designer to help you bring your idea to life from start to finish. From logos to packaging, apps to books, 99 Designs is a faster, simple, and affordable way to find and work with creative talent. You can save $10 today on your first design by visiting bit.ly/ap99designs. Give it a try.
Well, gosh, it's so interesting how you decide things and get places and you look back and you go, wow. Yeah, how did I pull that off? I guess it's funny. I've heard people say this before. If people were to tell you, oh yeah, then when you're, you know, in your 40s, this is going to happen. You go, what? No way. Especially you and I, before we started the show, we were talking about where we went to college and stuff. If you would have told me as a college student, oh yeah, and then this is it, and you're going to go here, and then this is going to happen, and then you're going to have these kids, and then you're going to start homeschooling, and then I would have been like, you're insane. Crazy. There's no freaking way. Okay. Nope. So I've always just been that person to follow my curiosity and curiosity is really those intuitive hits. So when you talk about intuitive, intuition, we all have this feeling. Our bodies are these amazing sensory centers. We have intelligence, we have soul, we have heart. I mean, we have this system that is working for us in the body. And I've been that person who has always really been into work, school. I love it. I never was that one who didn't want to go to class or didn't want to study. I mean, there were times if I didn't like the class, I didn't like the material, that was harder for me. But if I really liked, Yeah, or the teacher. The teacher was definitely could make or break you. But when I found a subject matter that was super interesting to me, and then I was good at, you know, it's easier to like something that when you're good at it, then I mean, that was it for me. I would just dive in. I wanted to go as far as I could. I wanted to get the best grade. I wanted to create an incredible project. And that would just lead me from one place to the next, to the next, to the next. And, you know, after, well, it was actually when I was still a student at the University of Florida, between my junior and senior. That's right. I know. I know. Exactly. I thought I'd have a life in Florida. I thought this is what I know. I lived in Florida and Georgia. Those are my two states that I spent my childhood in. And most people I knew, you just then stayed there. You know, you didn't go someplace else. That's what you did. There was plenty of cities in Florida I could go to.
Yeah.
I could move back to Georgia if I wanted the big city. A lot of people I went to college with, you know, their big move was to go to Atlanta. That was, you know, the big city. And I didn't want to do any of those things. I wanted to go to New York City. Once I had friends who came back from a summer internship after their junior year, and they were a year older than me, and they said they had done that and I should do it. It would just change my life. It would be incredible for my resume. I was a public relations major, and I thought, okay, I trust their judgment. I trust their guidance. I'm going to go do that. And so I did. And that really, when you talk about this worldwide business, this global clientele I get to serve now, I believe a big piece of that was my willingness to go to New York and to be in this, you know, hotbed of diversity. And there were just so many different types of people there. It blew my mind. The first month I literally was in culture shock and I thought I hated it because it was so different than anything that I could have imagined. Well, I missed my friends. I missed this boyfriend, but thank goodness I left because he was not a great boyfriend.
Yeah.
You know, and I just was so, they're all going to the beach and I'm dressing up in my suits and heels and, you know, going to Grand Central Station to the office. But it was such a wonderful move for me because it just taught me to think differently, to think bigger, to dream bigger, to be around people who are ambitious, who had been traveled places. And then, you know, I grew up traveling quite a bit. My mom took me to, you know, abroad, which was wonderful. But over time, I ended up getting hired by this company and I started working on a global piece of business for the company. I was traveling around to various countries, working on Pfizer, their Viagra account, which was a trip.
That's
and fine. Yeah, it was. It was celebrity stuff, big budgets, first class, the whole nine. And that, you know, I loved learning about the world, learning about different people. And I believe, and I still do believe that we do want the same things. We want a good life for our families. We want to feel connected. We want to feel loved. We want to share that love. And we want to, you know, do our part better. But over time, you know, working in these jobs, working on these clients, always feeling like I was using my gifts as a communicator, because that's who I am. I'm a communicator. I'm really good at it. But I felt like something was missing. I felt like I wasn't really doing the work I was put here to do. I'm very spiritual. My sister died when I was a teenager. She died from cancer, and she was 12 and I was 16. And so I had this very abrupt lesson, which is your life is not a guarantee. You don't get to live until you're 90 or 100 or until you've done all the things that you say you want to do just because. It could end today. It could end tomorrow. It could end next week. That's the great mystery. Yeah. And so I wasn't willing to just go through the motions and say, well, I should just be satisfied because I have a job that a lot of people would want. I have, you know, these big clients, or I'm making X amount of money. I started making a lot of money in that corporate space, more than I ever thought I would, because I didn't go into PR to make a lot of money. You know, that's not the career you go into if you want to make a lot of money. But I moved into a new career and I started making money because I was getting profit share from my conferences. I started producing conferences and it was, I cracked the six-figure mark, which I thought was the holy grail. And I did that and it wasn't
what
enough.
Happened?
Yeah, I go, once I make 100,000, like all my problems will go away. I mean, that's really this delusion. It was a delusion. It was an illusion because I did that and my problems were still there. Money wasn't the problem anymore. You know, I could pay my bills. I could live in a great apartment. I could buy the things that I wanted to buy, but the issues that I still had were still there. And that was a big wake up call for me. And so I have to say that yoga was a lifesaver for me. I started diligently practicing. I first uncovered it in college, but it was way back in the day before there was no Lululemon. There was no kind of everyone's doing yoga. It was still pretty not in the mainstream, but it's been around for more than 5,000 years. So it's not like it was new. It just wasn't really popular so much in the United States. But once I moved to New York and was in a super stressful environment and was just, you know, I'd have like panic attacks at work. I mean, it was so intense. I knew I had to find a tool that was going to help me stay grounded and stay healthy. And so it was yoga. And that eventually led me to decide I was going to go through a yoga teacher training, not knowing how in the, like, why? What was I going to do with this? Am I going to teach yoga? What am I going to do with this? Yeah. And I was still employed full time. I was just, you know, working all the time, traveling. I was married at that point. But there was something about that. You talk about intuition. There was something about that calling me forward saying, go check that out, Jenny. You don't have to know what you're going to do with it. You don't have to teach yoga. You don't, but just go follow it. Just go follow, sign up for it. Okay, dedicate yourself to it. Dive in. You love being a student. Go be a student of that. And I did. And it was towards the end of that yoga teacher training, a 3-month, 200-hour training in New York City while I was still working full time, that I got the courage to quit my job, quit the 6-figure job, went from 6 figures to 0 figures overnight.
Did something happen?
Yeah, something happened, which was I remembered who I was. And it wasn't that.
Gotcha.
I wasn't that. And no, literally, I went into work one day not planning to quit, having kind of daydreamed about it for years. And something happened where I just realized I couldn't be in this environment anymore. I just couldn't do it. It was it went against everything I stood for. And I got clear on what it was that I stood for because I didn't know anymore. You fall into line, you fall into kind of with the herd mentality and you do what you think you're supposed to do. And then you have those continuous wake-up calls and they're kind of quiet at first. They're kind of like, you know, they tap your shoulder. And you can ignore it because it's way more convenient to ignore it.
Yep.
And then you can't anymore. And so that particular day, I just started crying at my desk, to be straight up with you. Just started crying. It was a cubicle. So it wasn't like I could, you know, have complete privacy. I went into my colleague's office and we shut the door. And her and I had been talking for a long time, like what was our exit strategy. And I said to her, today's the day for me. Today's the day. I've been wondering what this day was going to look like, feel like, and today's it. And so then I called my husband and I called my mother and I told them what I was going to do. And then I called my boss and I quit. And it
was.
What
did your boss say?
She told me to think about it over the weekend. Oh. It was a Friday. And, you know, she was, and, you know, to be fair, I remember just feeling like, I didn't feel as well. It just wasn't the right place for me. And I look back and I love her. I'm so grateful for her. She had 4 kids. I had 0 kids at the time. And I remember just saying, I couldn't have kids in this environment. Way too pressure filled. And it's just not, I learned a lot about the leader I didn't want to be there. And also the leader I did want to be there. And, but that, at that point I was learning more about how I didn't want to do it. And so it was time for me to go. It was time for me to go. Everything I learned of how I did want to do it, I had already learned. And what was happening then was how I don't want to do it. And so I had to get out of there. So I took the weekend to just make sure I was clear on my decision. And that weekend, I was so lucky I had the full yoga teacher training weekend. And I shared with all these women, just so happened to be all women in the training, didn't have to be, it just so happened to be for my cohort. And they were so excited for me. And I kept that courage. And so on Monday, we connected again and I made it official. And took the next 2 weeks to kind of clear stuff out and finish up projects and really jump off the cliff into what next?
Yes.
What next?
Good for you.
Yeah. Yeah. And that what next led me to coaching. You know, I didn't know that I was going to do that. I didn't have this website in the works. I hadn't said I'm going to start leading programs and courses and have one-on-one clients. Like, I really was a blank slate. I just gave myself, and my husband was like my biggest fan. He said, Jenny, you're smart, you'll figure it out. And when I cleared the decks and had an open schedule and was able to just remove that unhealthy pressure and stress that was, eating me alive, it wasn't so long before I discovered the field of coaching and said, oh my goodness, that's what I've been doing my whole life. I didn't know it was a job. I didn't know it was a career. Great. I could sign up for a training and fine tune this raw skill set that I already have. Perfect. I'm in. And I did. And I started training to be a coach, like legit, straight away. And the business just started building itself because I was so excited. And I just shared my joy and my exuberance with anyone I would.
Who will listen.
Yes. Yeah. And people are going, I need to hire you. I need help. I'm like, great, let's do it. And it's just continued to evolve and grow. And I've invested heavily in myself. I'll continue to invest to learn and look at my blind spots and unlearn things that aren't healthy and helpful. And, you know, it's just been a wild ride. And I'm so, so grateful for it.
It's so awesome. So, like, why would you say, so you said like saleswomen, why does the world need more saleswomen? And I do think that it has to do with confidence. And I know that you and I, like, we have distinct passions about very specific things. And it's like, I feel like I know I can sell anything that I'm passionate about.
Yes.
And so, but for women who haven't quite found it, tell us, why does the world, first off, need more saleswomen like us?
Yes.
And like, how can it boost your confidence? And like, how can you sell anything?
Yeah. Well, the world needs more saleswomen because the world needs more women who know how to earn and who have money.
I love that.
Okay. Yeah. So when we're selling things, and we don't just sell things that then create wealth for us, but we can, and that's a beautiful thing. The more women who have money, and not just money that's given to us, so that's a beautiful thing too, okay, money in all the forms, but when we know we can generate that money because we can go connect with the client who needs our service, we can go create a program, an offering that we can go put out into the world because we understand marketing, we understand community building and nurturing an audience and solving a problem that your audience has. That right there is freedom. And so let's say a woman is in an unhealthy relationship and whoever she's in that relationship with has held the keys to the financial kingdom. That has left her at a disadvantage. It's hard for her to leave that relationship or to really establish a boundary and say this particular behavior, this whatever that's going on here, this has to end, right? We need to re-examine this. And I see this a lot. I grew up a child of divorced parents. And that was one of the things that I really took away from my parents getting divorced was that as a woman, and I'm happily married now 15 years, but I always knew I will make my own money. I will have a way to bring in financial abundance for my family because A, I freaking love it and it's fun. B, I can. And C, that is freedom. And that is the way forward. And I want my kids to see that too, that mom has stuff that she loves to do and mom brings in money for our family. And you can do it on your own time. I think some of our, you know, the old ways that we learned or maybe we saw work being in the past, you know, former generations or maybe even what we saw our parents doing or when we first started coming into the world. Like when I first got my, you know, that first job in New York City, you didn't work from home. Definitely not. I mean, the internet was in its infancy. Email was kind of new. There was no social media. You couldn't share documents. You know, you were sending things. It was old school. You couldn't collaborate in the way that you do now. And so if you wanted to work, you had to be in that office. If you have kids, which I didn't my first, you know, 10 years 10 plus years as a professional, I didn't have kids. And so I didn't have that question of, well, who's going to watch the kids, or how am I going to work and take care of them, or what's the dynamic going to be? Mm-hmm. And so for a lot of women, it was that choice. You either worked or you saw your kids. Yeah. Okay. Now it's different. It's so, so different. I feel like it's such a wonderful way, time to be alive. And so us as women, it gives us freedom. It gives us choices. It gives us options. It gives us strength within the relationship, because you know that you got stuff coming, you know. Mm-hmm. you could put something out there this month and you want to do something in your house. You want to put an addition on your house. You need a new car. You want to send your kids to this school, or, you know, sign up for this particular activity, or you want to give to a cause that you're really passionate about. Just go sell something.
Yep.
Just go sell something. It's been, you know, it's been going on since the beginning of time. But yet for a lot of women, they were given these messages that selling is bad. It's dirty. It's what used car salesmen do, but it's certainly not what a proper lady would do. Mm-hmm. You know, you need to go get the money from your dad or from your husband, mm-hmm. or from, you know, but to make it yourself, or you need to be in a job or in a career that doesn't really pay you that well, because though that's kind of work for women.
Yeah.
And so, right? You just didn't make that much money. You hardly made any money. And that was acceptable. That's just what you had to say, okay, because that's how it is, because the men have the jobs where you make a lot of money, but not women. And so we need to reexamine that. Okay. And then being able to sell an idea is huge. It's huge. Yep. We sell ideas all the time. We sell ideas to our kids, to our partners, to our families, to our communities, to our clients. We need to be able to sell ideas. And that selling, being able to sell anything, comes down to conviction. Mm-hmm. It comes down to commitment. And it's also you knowing, and I think this is huge, and I've uncovered this with my clients. Sometimes women are unwilling to sell because they don't trust themselves enough to deliver the thing that they sold.
Hmm. Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. Will you show up for the thing that you sold? Do you believe in your craft enough? Do you believe in your creation enough to know that whomever purchased it, they're going to have an incredible experience with your thing, with your service, with you?
And if you believe in it, then you would want to be selling it like hotcakes.
Absolutely. You know it's going to change their lives. You know, yes, it's going to give them so much pleasure, so much joy. It's going to solve the problem. Why would you keep that to yourself?
Right. That's why I don't understand people think I'm crazy. They're like, why do you want to teach planners to be planners, to do what you do? I'm like, because that's not what I do anymore. And that's not all I did. And why would I not want to teach people to be better in the industry? It lifts everyone up. And like, I don't know about you, but like, I'm not going to be working 250 weddings every single weekend for the rest of my life where I can't eat or pee for 30 hours. Like, mm-hmm. what? I mean, it's okay for 10 years when you're super young and your body can handle it, but then like, it has to come to a stop.
Yes.
So yeah, I don't understand that mindset sometimes. So something that I am fascinated with, like the moon and the stars and the seasons and like the magical rhythm and the flow and the growth and horoscopes and all that stuff. Like, what are your, as like an intuitive business coach, like, mm-hmm. what does all that stuff mean? And for people mm-hmm. who don't believe in that shit, because mm-hmm. they're especially, it seems to be men all the time. They're like, that's
because they're like, show me the data. It's too uh-huh. new.
And I'm like, they're like, all that horoscope stuff. It's like, you can relate anything any day. And I'm like, no, there are some, like, if I don't know, like if I'm unsure of myself, like, should I make this decision to say no to this client? Should I fire this client? Mm-hmm. Should I do, like, depending on what's coming up, like I read my horoscope and I'm like, holy shit, that is so spot on. And I'm like, this is what I'm going to do. And it helps mm-hmm. me make a decision that I'm at peace with. Mm-hmm. So what are your thoughts on all this? Like, mm-hmm. how do you incorporate this with your clients? Because this is fascinating to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's just the way that I live, breathe, do business, connect with people.
Yeah.
It's everything. It's everything. And this was something, I wasn't taught this in school. It's funny. I actually have a program called Magic Makers Collective, and it's where we co-create with the cosmos and co-create with the moon. And right before I was talking to you, I was leading a new training for clients in that membership. It's a membership. And I release a new training at around each new moon. So with each new lunar cycle, we have a new focus to really bring us forward through that cycle. And the theme this cycle is unlearning and learning. And so we're kind of re-examining all that you've been taught, all that you've been told, and seeing where you need to say, you know what? I don't think that's true. I don't think that's real for me anymore. And then what I need to learn instead is this. And so something I never learned in school was this. I took astronomy in college at UF. It was really challenging course. It was a lot of, you know, a lot of math, a lot of science, really getting in there, understanding like planets and how things move. But we didn't go into kind of the astrology element of it. Mm-hmm. And I also discovered astrology in college. And I remember the book that my friend had it. And when I discovered it one night from coming home super late from being out partying, I looked at it seriously. It was called The Only Astrology Book You'll Ever Need by this woman, Joanne Woolfolk. I highly recommend it. I just gave it as a gift for a friend who just graduated from high school. And it changed my freaking life. I remember reading it going, oh my gosh, this makes so much sense. And I understand why I have these kind of tiffs with this one friend of mine, because she's a Leo and I'm a Gemini. And then it made so much sense for me. And so how I use it and how I teach my people to use it is, as women especially, we need to have a deep relationship. You're invited to have a deep relationship with the moon. If you don't, you basically have robbed yourself from one of the most extraordinary relationships you'll ever have. The moon guides us forward. We cycle the same way the moon cycles. Okay. A lot of us have had periods in our life. We have the exact same cycle, our period, as the moon does. Okay. It's around 29 and a half days. So when you think about that, the way the moon changes each lunar cycle. Okay. We start at the new moon. I'll just kind of walk you through and show you how I use this to co-create, to lead client calls, to bring programs to life, to launch things, and how you all can figure out how to implement this in your world. So each cycle starts with the new moon. That's when you look up in the sky and you really do not see much light there. Okay. You'll start seeing the sliver on the right side of the moon. Okay. When you see the sliver of light on the right side of the moon, that shows you that we're in a new cycle, okay? So the moon is starting to what's called wax, get bigger. And that new moon, the energy of the new moon is rest, renewal, and ultravision. Rest, renewal, and ultravision. And so that energy is connected to when we bleed. And so when we would be on our period. And when I say we cycle the same, it doesn't mean that you're necessarily going to be having your period when it's a new moon, but sometimes that will happen. My cycle is very connected to the moon at this stage. It's not always, but just right now I'm pretty close to when the new moon is happening. That's when I'm on my period. So that feeling when I know for me, when I'm bleeding, when I'm on my period, I don't want to talk to anybody. I'm like, get away from me. I just need quiet. Yeah. I need everyone to leave me alone. I need to go into my red tent. Okay. There is that book, The Red Tent. It's an incredible book. If you haven't read it, go read it. Okay. So that's when I'm getting downloads. I have visions. I see things. I know things, and I want like a clear space to be able to receive that wisdom, because from there, I'm going to start creating a plan. I'm going to start setting those goals of what it is that I want to focus my energy on for that cycle. Okay. And gotcha. So that's what we're going to do at the new moon. Just spend some time. You might want to get into your bathtub, into your shower, into your bed, or just go sit out in nature. Get your journal and get clear on this is my intention for this lunar cycle. And here are the goals that I am going to work towards to help bring this intention to life. Okay. And then the moon starts growing and we come into the first quarter. About a week later, you get that first quarter moon where you see it looks like a half moon. Okay. And so that right side is fully lit. The left side you don't see. And the energy of the first quarter moon is growth, action, and commitment. Growth, action, and commitment. So at that point, you are working it. Okay. You're sending out those emails. You're making those calls. You're promoting your stuff. You are, you know, having those conversations. You are doubling down on the plan that came through at the new moon. When you said, you know what, I'm going to go for this. I'm going to learn this. I'm going to action this. So that first quarter moon, like the energy is fierce, you know, and you're mm-hmm. feeling it and your confidence is electric. Then you move into full moon. That is when you're in your fullest power. You know what the full moon looks like in the sky. And the full moon is about 1 week after the first quarter moon. Uh-huh. And all of these dates, if you have, that's why I still use a paper planner. Of course, I have a Google calendar and all that, but mm-hmm. I have a paper planner and I have wall calendars too. And they all have the moon phases represented on them, which is really important. I want everyone to know what phase the moon is in at any time, because you will start working with the energy instead of working against it. You'll see that you spend less time feeling like you're pushing a rock up the hill and more time being in flow. More time understanding your body, understanding what's going on, even when it feels like this is weird, you know, and we're in a lot of crazy, tumultuous, uncertain times right now. But yeah. Once you really are tuned into the energy, you feel the sense of groundedness, even when there's still so much that's in flux. Okay. So when you're at full moon, you're just in that fullest power. You know that your job is to go for things. You know that you can create the things that you desire. And this is when, as women, this is when we would be ovulating. This is when we could conceive a child. Okay. And so that full moon energy is when you can conceive that dream. You can conceive that new project. You can conceive that deal. You got it? Okay. And this is when we're not kind of hiding out. We're not going, well, I don't know if I do that. What if they say no? Or what if it doesn't work out? Like you're going for it.
Yeah.
You are freaking going for it. And then boom, we go into the last quarter moon, and that's about a week later. And that last quarter moon is when that left side of the moon is lit up. We don't see the right side. And the energy there is let go to rise higher. Let go to rise higher. So at that point, we're seeing what has manifested, what has brought us fruit from our efforts, fruit from our labor. And so some of those things have happened, some of those things didn't, and you realize, you know what, that actually was out of alignment. We're going to just pause that project. We're going to delete that project, or we'll come back to it later. But these other things have freaking rocked it, and you're going to continue focusing on those to make them even bigger, you know, as you focus your energy more intelligently as you move forward. You're also letting go of, you know, people, places, habits, things that can't come with you as you wrap up this particular cycle and move into the next cycle. Something important to note is we have 13 cycles in a year, 12 months. The months are very much kind of that masculine structure. It's what a lot of the world operates under, the monthly calendar. But the lunar mm-hmm. calendar is 13. So there's 13 cycles in a year. And as women too, we want to reclaim that number 13. So much of history has been afraid of strong women, been afraid yeah. of women who know their own power, because women who know their own power cannot be controlled. And so that number 13, I mean, look what we've been told about the number 13. It's a scary number. It's an unlucky number. You can't even put the 13 on a freaking elevator for a building. Because it's connected to strong women. And I just think it's fascinating. So reclaim the number 13, reclaim your connection to the moon, and gosh, you'll just wonder why you didn't start earlier.
Okay, so I'm totally going to go and download the moon calendar.
Yeah.
iCal.
Yes. Oh my goodness. Yes. It's a game changer.
Like, I need another calendar on my calendar, but this is important. Like, this is really cool stuff.
It is.
And like, I'll never forget this. And she's a business coach, intuitive, and she, and I know, like, I've met a few different people, and everyone like has their own style. And so at least that's what I've observed. But it was like day 4 of 7 on this GSD retreat in Cabo. Mm-hmm. And she came up to me one morning and she's like, "Can I talk with you privately?" I'm like, "Sure, what's up?" And she's like, "So I just want to give you a heads up, because I know everything that we're doing is very tech focused and everything." Like, I was using all like the screens and the Apple TVs, and like, mm-hmm. I'm just a tech geek. And she's like, "And I just want you to know that today Saturn. And I can't even remember the actual planets, but she's like
Mercury.
Mercury. That's it. Mercury and either Saturn or Pluto or something. She's like, they're crossing in alignment today and blah, blah, blah. And she's like, your technology's not going to work. And da, 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 da. And I'm like, okay. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's fine. And sure as shit, the internet goes out. I tried to get on my phone to transfer money to pay something for a client. My credit card gets stolen over the phone because I'm an unsecure Wi-Fi. Like, all this shit goes haywire. But, you know, it's like, I'm cool and calm and collective. I'm like, we can all just put big ass post-it notes up here and, you know, start to just brain dump everything. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's just like, you just kind of have to go with the flow.
You do.
And at the end of the night, I'm like, thank you so much for giving me the heads up. Like, that was really cool. I'm like, but kind of creepy at the same time.
Yes.
And so now, like, when weird stuff happens, I'm like, I'll Marco Polo her every once in a while. And I'm like, hey, what's going on with all the planets right now? Is something just going crazy? Because even last week, like, three of my Mac computers just all decided to, like, do something weird. And I'm just like, what is happening? It has something to do with, like,
do you know why, Angela?
Tell me.
Mercury retrograde, baby. Yeah, Mercury retrograde just started last week. So, yes, Mercury.
So what is that for people who don't know? Because she explained it to me, but what does it freaking mean?
Yeah, so, and I just, my fabulous paper planner, which I have, and I just love it. Katie Daisy is the creator of this. I've been using it for the last few years. It's changed my life. And so I just opened my 2020 at a glance at the beginning of that calendar, and I have highlighted in the various spots where it was happening in 2020, the Mercury retrograde dates. So that's the thing where you don't want to be caught off guard, where you're going, why did all my computers die? It's because there's freaking Mercury retrograde. And so Mercury is the planet that rules communication. I'm a Gemini, and so Mercury is my ruling planet. Like, I communicate. Like, that is my love language. I know how to communicate. So when Mercury goes retrograde, it just means that you want to be prepared for technology going on the fritz, for a breakdown in communication. You know how sometimes you're talking to someone and you feel like we're on two different planets right now? Like, they're not getting it. I'm not understanding what they're saying. It's like the lines got crossed, and you're almost aliens and you don't understand each other's language, but normally you do, but not right now you do, or whatever. Mm-hmm. And so you also, it's a time when Mercury's in retrograde. Not that you can't embark on deals with people or deals. I know some people who won't. They're like, I don't do business during, I just don't. I won't sign a contract. I won't engage in a new deal because Mercury is in retrograde. Which, you know what? If that's the way you need to do it, that's the way you do it. In my world, I will still engage, you know, in signing contracts on either end, you know, in my business or if I'm going to sign on for something. But I'm just very laser focused on ensuring that everyone is clear on the terms of the agreement. And so this is where you don't go like, oh, we talked about it. No. What is it in writing?
Right.
You need to make sure that everyone is clear on it and that you don't assume anything. Because when Mercury goes retrograde, it can lead to miscommunication when it comes to business relationships, deals, your personal relationship, your romantic relationship. You can kind of start having these weird tiffs and you're going, what's going on here? So be aware of that. Yeah. I highlighted in my calendar. So I'm not thrown off when it does happen. And then of course with tech, just know, okay, that could, sometimes my computer like flipped out during Mercury retrograde, but then once retrograde ends, it just fixes itself. So yeah, I don't rush out and get the new thing. I go, okay, let's just let it ride out. And then once the planet goes back, it might just work again.
So when is the planet going back after this?
July 12th, 13th. Around there.
Oh shit. That's like, so, I mean, seriously, like I mean, I don't flip out. I just, I go to the Apple store and thank God I have a joint venture business with them, because otherwise I would have to like do what most people do, which is like stand in line and get an appointment. And I'm like, I don't have time for all that shit. So thank God, like I have a great relationship with them. And so like email my JV guy and I'm like, Marshall, something just today, and my iMac is new. It is brand new. And I've hardly used it. I've just edited on it. And he's like, I'll get you in. And I mean, I look like a crazy person coming in with three big ass computers. And so I'm like, if I can at least just get one of them back today. So they did get me my two Mac or MacBook Pro and then my Air, but then my brand new iMac is still there and it's been there for like over a week. And they're like, well, your motherboard went bad. And I'm like, this is a brand new freaking computer. Like, is it because my office has windows in front of it and the sun rises on that side? I'm like, what the hell did I do? But I still don't have it back. And so,
I'm interested too. I would wonder too with motherboard, like, is there something with mother that just something that came through as you said that with mother? And I have lots of mothering
what
stuff
that I've dealt
with in my life. I don't know, maybe with your own mother, with your view on what mothering is, that just is worth examining, you know, worth really getting into. And the thing with tech too is, I mean, we don't really control it. It has a mind of its own. When mine, you know, breaks or something happens, I almost feel betrayed. Like, how could you do this to me? I thought we had a relationship. I thought we had an agreement. You always work. Like, you don't break. You don't have a sick day. Okay. But see, what was smart that you've done is that you have backups, you know, or you have a plan. You've got Marshall to call. And so you're not going, well, I don't have computers for the next few weeks. No, you've got the thing that you can do. I have the same thing. You know, I have a laptop, my phone, and then I have my desktop. And the thing that happens in my house, sometimes the internet gets crazy. And I live in the country, and my husband, I said to him recently, I think we need to call the people to like come check on the internet, because I don't think it should happen so much where we have these issues. Mm-hmm. You have to look at the larger thing. What is going on here? But what I do is I've hardwired my desktop. So if the Wi-Fi, it's the Wi-Fi that we have issues with sometimes. If the Wi-Fi goes wonky, it doesn't impact my desktop. So if I have videos or podcast interviews or whatever, I'm doing trainings for my clients, I can still show up for that. It's just the rest of the house kind of has to deal with stuff. Gotcha. So, you know, you look at, I learned that lesson from John Lee Dumas, you know, of EO Fire.
Yeah.
Podcast. I was interviewing him for my show.
That's awesome.
And it was, we were having this weird connection, or no, he was on being on my, I can't remember if he was interviewing me or vice versa, but he goes, you should hardwire your computer. I go, what's that? And he told me, I go, okay. And so from there, you know, you just learn as a business owner, what do you need to do to reduce the risk, reduce the level of risk, or the risk is part of life, but can you reduce the fact that you plan this thing and then you're, you know, your Wi-Fi goes on the fritz, but you're hardwired, so you still have internet. You know what I mean? Yep. Or if your technology breaks, well, you've got, you know, the private number to the Apple guy, you know, the Genius Bar. So you think about what are ways to minimize the risk and then make it so that you can stay in business. You know, you don't have to cancel all your stuff or not show up for your clients, because that's not what professional business owners do. And so we have to look at how we can show up as professionals so that our clients know we've got their back. We're going to show up the way that we say that we're going to. And I think that's a great lesson that we share with our people. I always say to my people, you got to show up. Do you show up consistently? Do people, do they know they can trust you? We have these, I have an online business. I work from home. I love it. But I'm a professional. Make no mistake about it. I run a legit operation.
Yeah.
If you want something from me, you are going to get delivered an incredible experience, an incredible thing. We put our heart and soul into this. And I think as women too, we have a responsibility to share that with our people.
Yeah.
You know, that just because you work from home or you have this thing that is not kind of the traditional way we were taught, you know, businesses, you have a brick and mortar operation and you have a gazillion staff or what have you. I mean, it can be anything these days, but it should also be something where you know that you deliver. And your people know that you deliver.
Absolutely. This is so cool. This is so cool. Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh. I love this stuff. So for people who don't know how to say no, And they think that they need to do more to make more. But really, your philosophy is do less. Like, if you guys look at the homepage of her website, it's like, it's literally like, do less and make more, like, seriously. So if we're intentional about like the moon and the stars and, you know, and putting our energy into these places to really build our brand, then I feel like things would feel as though it's more falling into place to where it's like, let's work smarter, not harder kind of thing. And so, but for you, like, what does that really mean? Like, do less, make more.
Yeah. Well, for me, this is re-examining all that you've been told around work. And
which is pretty much all wrong in my
opinion. Exactly. Well, you know what, Angela? It was the masculine structure.
Yeah, it was totally.
So often the thing that kept women out, because, you know, for a lot of women, not all, I became a mother. I chose that path. It chose me. I have three kids. So for some women, again, because the traditional role said that was the woman's job, was to raise the kids. And so if you're, if the way that work was Monday through Friday from 9 to 5, and you're going, well, what about my kids? Then it was this thing of, well, I guess that means I can't work because I won't see my kids, or who's going to, you know, take them to school or pick them up or do all the things that need to be done. And so when I moved into the working world, that was the construct of work. Okay. You're going to come to this office from Monday through Friday. And it was my first job. It was not 9 to 5. It was like 9 to 8. I'm going, oh my gosh, this is a lot. Where's my life?
You're like, okay, this is a job.
I go, how long do I have to do this for? Oh my. And I enjoyed my work, but I want to do other things.
Yeah.
And I don't feel like we need to be behind a computer every day, all day and all the time. Cause then you miss out. Like, your nature is calling, and I love being outside and love just exploring. And I guess my greatest ideas when I'm not behind my freaking computer, when I'm not at this desk, when I'm out running, I'm out hiking, I'm doing my yoga, I'm with my dog, I'm with my kids, I'm with my husband. So once I, you know, that was like just a huge piece of my discontent in that corporate life, was I don't want to be in this office all the time. I wanted to work a different environment. I wanted to work from home. I wanted to have Mondays unscheduled. I wanted, you know, I just, and I didn't see how that was supported in that environment. So I became an entrepreneur kind of just because I saw that coaching was my thing. I go, oh, okay, I'm going to have my own business then. Well, let me learn about that. Like, how do you have your own business? Okay, I'll figure it out as I go. And then once I started having kids, I didn't want to go back to that old way of working, but I also like to make money. And I had that six-figure career. And so I didn't want to go back to, oh, okay, I'll make like 25,000 or I make 50,000. Not that there's anything wrong with that. And if that's what someone desires, that's beautiful. It's whatever is right for you. But I have big dreams and big ambitions. And I know that money is a tool for making things happen. And money gives you choices. It gives you freedom. I love to be able to give to these incredible causes that need my support. I just love to be able to spread the wealth. And I said, okay, well, how could I deconstruct this and figure out what are the activities that I do that net the greatest return on my investment, and what's going to allow me to feel deeply connected to my work and deeply satisfied? What's going to allow me to have a team that I can pay to help me run this thing and take care of our clients and take care of this mission? And what, like, how do I want to design this so that I can sustain this? I could literally do this for the rest of my life. I don't say, oh, I can't wait till I retire. I was talking to my financial advisor about this, and he goes, well, you know, you can retire. I go, I just need to be clear with you. I don't look to that day.
Right.
I'm not like, oh, I'm counting down the days till I can retire. I remember when my dad had the countdown. I'm not in that camp. I want to do this for as long as I am healthy and of sound mind. I will do this work. I will support people in the ways that I have been gifted. And so when I could say, great, that means I can just, I honestly, I focus my work on right now, and this will change as seasons change, as my kids change, but I schedule things on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
Okay.
Mondays and Thursdays, I keep open, you know, with some exceptions, but I'm very focused with what I call batching my tasks and chunking my time. And so I back to back have things scheduled. And so I'm in the zone to be able to lead a training, to talk to you for a podcast interview, to talk to clients, to create copy, like whatever it is I'm doing. I just am really, really like ninja with batching my tasks and chunking my time. I teach this to my clients and I love it. It's like a game to me, a fun game where I can see how efficient can I be with my time. And then what are the returns that we get when it comes to our satisfaction, the way that we're impacting our clients, the money that's coming into the business, the good that we're doing. And I think it's the greatest opportunity, not just for women, but for men too, to re-examine what you've been told that you, from Monday through, this is what you've got to do. And listen, if that's what you want to do, freaking go for it. My dad, when he was working, he had to work in that framework. He would have lost his mind if he didn't do that. Like that's just what he knew. And for me, you know, I also homeschool my kids and I did this before the pandemic. And so how can I do that and still have a business? Well, I had to become somebody who played with this concept of doing less and making more.
That's awesome. This has been so good. I could talk to you all day long, but we're out of time, unfortunately. Okay. So everybody go download the full moon calendar. And make sure, so if people want to get in touch with you, so I know that you have this new class for like, you call it Magic Makers Coach Certification in September. And so tell us more about that.
Yeah. And so it sounds like what you do in your business, me having been this coach since 2008, I got to this point where all my like individual clients were coming to me going, wait, okay, can you teach me how to do what you do as a coach? Like, what do you do? Like, what exactly is that? And then can you teach me how to have a business doing that? So I was doing a lot of that kind of just one-off. And then I saw a big issue happening in the industry where a lot of people were trained classically in how to coach and they were really awesome coaches, but they did not know how to have a business as a coach.
Right.
So then they can't really coach if they can't make money doing it.
Right.
Right. Unless they have another job or unless they have, you know, money from other sources. And then I saw other people who were incredible marketers. Like they could sell air, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And but yeah. But they were call themselves coaches because there is this big explosion of coaches in the industry and everyone was calling themselves coaches, but they didn't really know what coaching was. And so they were doing a disservice to the craft of coaching, but they were incredible marketers. And for a lot of them who didn't have the integrity of coaching in their heart, they put a bad taste in people's mouths around what coaching really is. And so eventually I just said, wait, I guess I'm the one who's going to solve this issue in the market. I'm not going to wait for somebody else to solve this issue. I'm going to. Mm-hmm. And so I created our very own coaching school. We created it back in 2015. It originally was called Get Gutsy Coach Training School. My first ever book is called Get Gutsy. And it just was a natural extension from that. And we brought a lot of women through that program. I'm really proud of the work that we did. And it was interesting, Angela, last year, you know, you go through these evolutions and where you just know that old way, it's done. You know, it might be done in a business, in a relationship, where you're living, a habit. And I knew that although that program was solid, we needed to evolve. And I couldn't keep selling it in its old form. And so I worked with an extraordinary coach I'd worked with through the years. I went out to Arizona to work with her privately and just dissected it and kind of blew it up and realized that this whole realm that we were talking about being a magic maker, which is my membership is called Magic Makers Collective. I realized that's the brand. That's where the brand is evolving. And so the coach certification became Magic Makers Coach Certification. And a big piece of what we teach in there is how to co-create and coach with the cosmos. So that framework I was sharing with you all is a big piece that we teach our clients who come in there is how do you co-create and coach with the cosmos? What are the gifts and tools and skills that you have? And so our two areas that we focus on are the craft of coaching and the business of coaching. And then we get granular and we focus on intuitive coaching. And you can bring intuitive coaching out in so many different realms, you know, as health and wellness, relationships, business, consulting. I mean, just in your family. I mean, some people, they'll go through this and it'll just help them be a better communicator across the board, a better leader, a better speaker, a better anything. And then others are going to take it and really, you know, go down deep in their coaching business and lead programs, lead retreats, mm-hmm. courses, one-on-one work. They're going to create movements, communities, all that. Yeah. So everyone, if you want to go check it out, magicmakerscoach.com.
I love it. And then you also offered a free copy mm-hmm. of your Reclaim Your Time template, which yes. huge fan, and learn how to create a schedule. And so you and I do something very similar where we have learned to time block and time chunk yep. and leave other time open for, hey, life happens, shit happens, it happens.
Yes.
You know, so, and it's like, you do have to be flexible, but where can people go get that free template?
Yes. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Just go to jennyfenig.com/schedule. That's my name, jennyfenig.com/schedule. You can grab it. We'll give you the template itself. And then I guide you through the process that we mentioned today of just that task batching, time chunking. It's so funny, Angela, and I know you and I both do it, that so many people don't know about this. I mean, these are the other things you weren't taught. And so we were just right. taught to squander our time. We were taught no to way. Just squander it.
Yep.
And you know what? You are going to have to work 40 hours a week. That's just what it is. And so you're like, well, I might as well waste the time because I have to do it for 40 hours. Like, what if you could accomplish so much more in 20 hours? Like, yep. And I think people get freaked out. They go, well, what would I do with the rest of that time? Well, maybe you'd spend it with some people that you really cared about, you know, other than your clients. Maybe you would spend it learning a new skill. You'd spend it exercising. You'd spend it giving to a philanthropy or working mm-hmm. on some social causes. I mean, so many things can happen. And right. so, yeah, it's just, I'm so excited that we had this conversation and that we got to connect and share some things that are truly game changers for everyone who is tuning in today.
Absolutely. What's your favorite platform for people to connect with you on?
IG or FB. Okay. IG, it's just my name, Jenny Fenig. Facebook, I have a business page, but you also, my personal page, honestly, I'm much more active on, and you can just follow me there too. I'm
gotcha.
Very outspoken, and you will know my viewpoints pretty quickly.
I want to follow you just to read, like, what the hell's coming around the corner tomorrow?
Totally. Do that. And often what I post on IG, I'll then just stick it, you know, I'll just have it replicate and go to Facebook. But yeah, I would love to connect with everybody, with Angela, with everyone else who's tuning in, and just let me know that you heard me here on Angela's podcast, and I'll know that you're cool people.
Awesome. Yay. We only have fine, cool people here.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
All the stick in the muds get off.
Yes. And I love that you throw out some good cuss words here and there. I'm like, me too.
Yeah. That's just how I grew up.
You know, it's just real. It's real life.
Yes, it is. Well, thank you so much for your time today. And everyone that's listening, thank you so much for your time today. I know that you walked away with great, great, great nuggets. And be sure to tune in next week for another episode of Business Unveiled. Everybody have a great day. Bye.
Now that you have all the tools you need to conquer the world in GSD, just share this with your friends and your fellow GSD leaders, and be sure you're a subscriber so you never miss the juicy details of Business Unveiled. And you can ask Siri to listen to the latest episode, but you got to be a subscriber. Before I go, I have a huge favor to ask, and it would mean the world to me. While you're listening, snap a quick screenshot, post it to your Instagram story, tag me at GSDleader_, and share with me your top takeaway from this episode and how it relates to you. Until next time, remember, stay productive and profitable.
You've been listening to Business Unveiled with Angela Proffitt. Join us next time as we share our experiences to help you be more productive and profitable in your creative business. For more great resources, visit angelaproffitt.com.